We don't look through the door we just came from, but we keep going ahead and keep our eyes on the Lord and see where the Lord leads each one of us. And we know that the world is ever-changing, but one thing that we know for sure is that God will take care of those who are His, and He'll take care of His flock. And to read your bulletin, to know what's going on. And this next item, and because you were told last year about this item, we probably forgot this year, but just a reminder that we would like to bless the Galavanco family with a monetary donation to be handed in today or next Sabbath morning, January the 9th, the latest. So I pray that you would all want to be a part of this gift. Fruitful and acceptable worship begins before it begins. So we stand for the call to worship. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? Shall we pray? Our most gracious Father, thank you for yet another year, that we may see your workings in our lives, that we would be glad and rejoice in it. Open our eyes that we may continually see our need of you. Lead us in the paths of righteousness for your name's sake. Let us see others through your eyes and not through our own, and let others see you in us. Open our ears that we may hear your still small voice saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. Most of all, forgive us, for we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. As Moses prayed, Father, show us thy glory in whatever way you choose. I pray also for the speaker, Carmani, and his family, that you would continue to be their refuge and their strength in 2016. I pray this in your son's name. Amen.
Good morning, church. We aren't awake yet. Okay. Good morning, church. I'm glad that everyone could make it to church safely this morning, even though it is extremely cold out. So we're going to start with our first song, number 422, Marching to Zion.
Thank you.
morning. I hope that everyone is happy to be here. So please, I want to see everyone singing as we sing number 249, Praise Him, Praise Him.
Thank you.
our Savior lives. So please join us in singing our opening song, 251, He Lives. Please stand.
Good morning and Happy New Year, Church. Quite an appropriate song to begin the year with. He lives within my heart. It is now time for a congregational prayer. Today, we are praying for the Bermuda Conference. During this quinquennium of revival and transformation, we will continue to pray for the conferences as designated by the North American Division of Seventh-day Adventists, of which we are a part. And today we're praying for the Bermuda Conference. The president is Kenneth Manders. The secretary is Dewan Tull. And the treasurer, Aaron Spence. Because we're praying for revival and reformation in our church, we will pray for a commitment to daily study of the Word of God and prayer, because that's only what will change us, will transform us into the people that we ought to be. And we also want to pray today for the students and teachers and our maids. As is customary, we invite you, if you feel so impressed, to come to the front to join us for prayer.
Thank you.
Oh, Father in heaven, we thank you that you have brought us here together on this first Sabbath of 2016, where we can fellowship together, where we can study your word, and encourage one another as we journey to the kingdom. We thank you for each family represented here. Lord, we thank you for the trials that we've had in the past. And as we begin this year, we ask that you will continue to go with us. And in spite of the difficulties that we would face, we thank you that you've promised that you will never leave us and you will never forsake us. We've come this morning, our needs differ. But one thing we all have in common is a renewed relationship with you. We thank you, Lord, that you have promised that you will be with us when we come to worship. And we ask that whatever we do here today will bring honor and glory to your name, and that every person would have an experience with you that would change their lives forever. In a special way this morning, we want to pray for our students who are part of this congregation, whether they are at university or high school, college, or public primary school. Lord, we ask that you will be with them. Bless them in whatever they do, and may they be a light to their peers and also to their teachers. We thank you for the teachers in our midst. We ask that you would continue to be with them as they dedicate their lives to service, to make an impact for your kingdom. We thank you in a special way for the parents of both the teachers and the students in our midst. We ask, Lord, that you will continue to be with them and help them to be the support, the best support they can be for their family. This morning, we want to lift the Bermuda Conference to you and ask that as they minister on that island nation, that you would be with them and help them to do your bidding every day so that the people they influence would make a difference in this world and for your coming kingdom. We want to thank you in a special way that you have given us your word. And we ask, Lord, that you will give us each one of us the determination to carve out some time each day so we can spend meditating on your word, applying it to our lives, and witnessing as a result. We thank you, Lord, that you will never give up on us. This morning, in a special way, we want to pray for Kamani as he brings the word to us. We ask, Lord, that you will use him to influence us for your kingdom. We want to think of the people in our midst who are not enjoying health. Be with them in a special way. We want to think of Carolyn, and we want to also think of Sister Sampaio. Help them to sense your presence. We think of our members who are elderly, and whether they're at their home or in retirement or nursing homes, Lord, may your angels touch them at this time. In a special way, we want to surrender our lives to you, especially those of us in leadership, that we would lead your people in love. Give us, Father, the gift of patience and endurance. And Lord, when Sabbaths like these are over on this earth, may each one of us here today, along with our families and other loved ones and friends for whom we have prayed, have an opportunity to sit around your throne and tell each other how glad we are to be in your kingdom. Hear our prayers today, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Good morning, boys and girls. Good morning. We want to welcome you guys to service this morning. I trust that you guys had a good Christmas and you're looking forward to the new year. This morning, our story is about obedience. How many of us always listen to our parents? All the time. Parents, can you see the hands of your kids? They listen to you all the time. That's very good. As long as you guys are speaking the truth, that's good, okay? So in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1, what did I say? Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1, it says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right." Now, I have a story this morning, and the story is basically about myself. And do we have to separate your two? No. Okay, thanks. Okay, so the story is about myself. And I hope that we can all learn something about it, right? Now, both my parents were farmers. And sometimes my dad would say to me, "Go feed." They held them. He kept bunnies, right? Now, they weren't the cute kind that you want to take home and play with, right? And he said to me that I should go. Can you move for a second, please? Or you want to move and sit down here? Don't bump your sister. Okay, he said to me that I should go and just put some vine in the pen. I hated doing that. Just really hated doing that. So most times I would not go, right? But this one Sabbath morning, when I'm supposed to be getting ready to go to church, I figured, oh, I want to go under the mango tree because mangoes was my favorite fruit. So I decided I was going to come up with a very good reason for my mom as to why on Sabbath morning I had to go to feed the animals. So I said to her, "Mommy, Daddy told me to go feed the animals for him." And she said, "On Sabbath morning?" I said, "He said to me yesterday that I should go, and I didn't go yesterday." So she said, "Go quickly, make sure you come back right away," right? And she said to me, "Do not take any tools with you." And what type of tools does a farmer use? Something that cuts.
A saw.
A saw, no. A farmer, a cutlass. Some people call it a machete, right? So of course, I picked up one and was on my way to go feed the animals, which I should not have been doing in the first place. And my mom yelled out to me and she said, "Please do not take a machete. Go quickly and come back to get ready for church." I said, "No, mommy, I'll be right back." And I had a machete in my hand. I walked down to go feed the animals, and the first piece of stick I saw, I tried to chop it. Don't ask me why, I was a kid. As soon as I chopped the stick, the cutlass just bumped on the stick and it bumped on my foot. What do you think happened there? Cut my foot, started bleeding, panicked. I had to go home, right? Now, if I had obeyed my parents, would I have even gone to the farm that day? If I had obeyed my parents, would I even have cut my foot that day? No, right? So I did not obey my parents. And the short end to the story is that I had to end up going to the nurse's home to get stitches put in, and the nurse was also a Seventh-day Adventist. So I had to listen to a whole sermon from the nurse and then also from my mom. So as we go about our daily lives, let us remember when our parents talk to us, it's because sometimes they've been there, right? And we should always obey our parents in the Lord, for this is right. Have a pleasant day. Amen. Oh, sorry. We need to pray. Can I have a volunteer, please? Okay, Cherise.
Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for everything you've given us. And please bless everyone, that everyone listen to their parents and honor you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Good morning. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I know it's a little cold out here, but we could be a little bit more happier with where we are today than saying good morning, Harford. Let me try that again and see if I'll get a better response. Happy Sabbath and good morning, everybody. Okay, I'll take that. Some people are not taking it, but it's all right. It's another time that we are going to continue to worship our Lord by returning tithes and offerings. And the question I want to ask today, if you want to answer it, you may answer it quietly within yourself, or you may talk about it as a family, but does God need our money? Does God need our money? If yes or no, that's not up to you. I don't need an answer right now. You can talk about that. But I'm going to tell you this, that God does not need our stuff. He never has needed anything that we own, that we may return to him or anything like that. He doesn't need it. So why do we give if God doesn't need it? We give because he is a glorious God who has given us everything that we ever need. Remember, I said need, not want. So when he gives us stuff, we give back to him as a sign of our appreciation for what he has done for us. I remember sharing is a very, very difficult thing, especially for the young ones. When you give them a piece of candy and you ask them to share with their friends, it's a very trying moment for them because the candy, they just want it for themselves. So when you find one who is willing to share, there, that is something huge. So someone told us that we behave like little children when it comes to returning stuff to God. When we give our children, be it money, toys, candy, for those who give their kids candy, and you ask them to give one, let's say you give them 10 of them, and you ask your kid to give you one back, how many of them do give you anything back? I want to see by show of hands. How many of you get stuff back? Some do. Most of the time you get zero. They want it all. And so we behave like that when it comes to God because he has given us all, and then he asks us to just return a little bit, not because he needs it, but because we need to show some appreciation for his mercies in our lives, and we give him back zero. This is a new year that we are beginning, and I want to pray that we may commit ourselves to returning that which belongs to God in the house of storage. And also let's make a commitment to return just a little bit of that we have been blessed with as offering so that we may be able to continue to have some light in the house of God, some heat when it is winter, or maybe some air conditioning in the summer, and a little bit to help our neighbors and friends. That's why we give. I hope that the Lord will talk to us, that we may return faithfully, and let me call upon the deacons and deaconesses to assist us with that. Thank you. Let's say a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for such a beautiful day that you have given to us. And as we continue to worship you, we want to pray that you may pour your Holy Spirit in your hearts, that our minds may be open to receive from you. We want to thank you for giving us everything that we ever need. And we have just returned a little bit of what we have to your throne of glory so that you may use it to your honor and glory. May you bless that we have returned in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you all please rise for the reading of God's word? I'm going to be reading Genesis 2, 15 to 25. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him." Now out of the ground the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all the livestock, the birds of the heavens, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man. And while he slept, he took one of his ribs, closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. And then the man said, This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. Thus ends the reading of God's word. You may be seated.
El Shaddai, El Elyon Ha'Adonai, age to age you're still the same, by the power of the name. El Shaddai, Erkom Kana Adonai, we will praise and lift you high. El Shaddai, through your love and through the ram, you saved the son of Abraham. Through the power of your hand, you turned the sea into dry land. To the outcast on her knees, you were the God who by your mighty hand, you set your children free. El Shaddai, El Elyon Ha'Adonai, age to age, you're still the same, by the power of the name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Erkom Kana Adonai, we will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. Messiah are to be. Though your words became the plan, they just could not understand. Your most awesome work was done through the power of your Son. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyon Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same. By the power of your name, El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Kumkana Adonai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai, El Shaddai.
Happy New Year, Church of God. Seems like I'm not hearing correctly. Something may be wrong with my ears, or something is wrong with your voices. But I'm going to say something's wrong with my ears. So can we be a bit louder than that? Happy New Year, Church of God.
Happy New Year.
God is good. All the time, when praises goes up, blessings come down. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. What do you say? I just want you to understand that the same God that kept you through 2015 is the same yesterday, is the same today, and is the same forever. So you don't have to worry about what's ahead of you. Just continue to trust in God, and everything will be all right. This sermon that I'm going to preach, it says, it begins with me. It's not a typical New Year sermon that I'm going to preach. And to be honest with you, it's a sermon I don't want to preach. If I have my own way, I will be preaching today on the topic, Hallelujah, anyhow. Because the first time when I was told that I was the one that was supposed to preach, that sermon, Hallelujah, anyhow, has been prepared, but God won't have me to deliver that sermon. You know, this sermon that I'm going to preach, I have a disagreement with my wife, and I was praying. Yeah, I see how the eyebrows go wide, eyes go wide open. And while I was praying, God put this in my spirit. Now you know why I don't want to preach this sermon. And God put it in my spirit, and God says, I said to God that, no, I can't do it. I literally said, God, you must be crazy. And I said, there's no way. And I told my wife that God wants me to preach this message. Do I have your permission? Honestly, I want her to say no. And she said yes. So, I'm going to do it. And God told me that, you know, I want to preach this sermon because there are some people in this church that need to hear this message. And there are some people in this church that are just like you. So as I go through the sermon, you will realize, and I will embark some more on what happened throughout the sermon. So, when that's all said and done, I know you guys won't fall asleep because you want to hear. You want to hear what Kermani did, eh? You will hear what Kermani did. So just keep the preacher in your prayers. If I said I'm not nervous, I would be telling a lie. I am nervous. And that's not typically me. So I guess that's a good thing. So can we just get into attitude of prayer as we pray, please? Praise. Loving Father God, I invite your presence right now in this place. This first Sabbath of the new year. And you have chosen me to deliver a message that I really don't want to deliver. I'm asking you, Heavenly Father, that you may prepare the heart or the hearts of people that need to hear this message. You told me that somebody needs to hear this message, and I chose to obey you, O God. Let this message be so simple that even a child may hear. I ask all these mercies in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm wearing this nice, beautiful, pretty shirt. It was a gift given to me by one of my favorite persons in this church. She don't want me to say her name, but she knows herself, and I told her that anytime I'm going to preach, I'm going to wear it. So you know who, you know yourself, I wear your shirt. All right. It begins with me. Turn to the person beside you and said, it begins with me. And, you know, this is a husband, most likely a husband and wife sermon. So if best as possible, if you could sit where your husband or your wife is, that would be nice. If you look at the scripture reading that's taken from Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. What did I say, church? Genesis 2, verse 15. And I'm going to read verse 1. 2 verse 15. I'm going to read chapter, verse 15, sorry. And the Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. I know there are some translations that say to tend, T-E-N-D, or to cultivate, or to work. Those are all correct. But if you look back and the Hebrew terms, the Hebrew word that translated for tend is habad, A-B-A-D, habad. That means to work or to serve. So pay attention. So God put the man, and if you look at the context, this is not mankind. This is man, as in ish. The Hebrew word for man is ish, H-I-S. So when you look at this text in the Hebrew form, you will see ish. So this doesn't mean mankind. This means literally man, as in the masculine figure of a male. So God placed the man into the garden to cultivate or to dress or to tend. Bible scholars don't like to use the word dress because it comes with more like adornment. So they rather to use the word to tend or to cultivate or to work. Even though just in itself, it's okay, but it's not the most correct. So the Garden of Eden, God placed the man to work. Not just that, if you look into the verse itself, it's a twofold reason why the man placed in the garden. One is to work, or to dress, or to cultivate, and the next one is to keep. That Hebrew word for keep is shamar, S-H-A-M-A-R, shamar. It literally means to exercise great care over. To exercise great care over. Shamar. So follow with me, church. So God has placed the man in the Garden of Eden to dress, or to cultivate, or to work, or to tend. I like the word cultivate, because cultivate have two definitions. To cultivate also is a form of tilling the soil. Cultivate also means to develop. So when you cultivate something, you develop it. So remember, the Garden of Eden was the home for the man. There was no woman yet. Even though if you look at chapter 1, where it talks about chapter 127, where it talks about God create Eden, male and female, but chapter 2 is like it rewind and it gives you in more details what takes place. So you might look and you might say, but in chapter 1, verse 27, it says God created them male and female. And in chapter 2 here, it's saying, it's acting like there was no female. No, there was no female at that point in time. So the Garden of Eden was given to the man as his home. So follow me closely, church, where I'm going. The two part of the text, of the verse, is to work and to keep. So I'm telling you now, church, that the responsibility is given to the man, that whatsoever is broken in your house that need to fix, the man's responsibility is to fix it. And I'm not talking about fixing a pipe. I'm not talking about fixing a furniture that is broken. I'm talking about when there are disagreements with you and your spouse, it is your responsibility to go and fix it. Why? Because God gave you the garden to dress and to keep. And the word shamar in the Hebrew term, it means to exercise care. The word shamar means to exercise great care over. To exercise great care over. So if something going on in your house that is not right, then the responsibility as a man to keep it, shamar, exercise great care over, then the responsibility falls on us to go and fix it. And my wife and I have a disagreement, and I am at my bedside and I'm praying to God. And I'm saying, God, she's the one that did wrong. But yet, she's not coming to me to apologize. And I am not going to her. And I'm right at my bedside, and I knelt there. And God says to me, get up off your knees. Pull your pants up and go do what's right. Go do what's right. And right there, God put in my spirit, Genesis 2 verse 15, and he said, go look over that text. I said, God, she's the one that done me wrong. God said, you need to go and fix it. And God said, moreover, what has happened to you, you focus so much on one part. You see, the part that said to tend or to work, God says to me, literally, that you have been a good worker. You make sure your bills are paid. You make sure everything is okay, food on the table, clothes to wear. But God says, Kermani, you are lacking. You are lacking. And I said, God, what are you talking about? And God said, I gave you your garden to keep it. In other words, shamar, as I said before, it means to exercise great care over. It means to take care of it. It means to guard. It also means to watch over. It means to maintain, and it means to protect. That's the Hebrew word, shamar. And God said, while you are there doing a good job in cultivating or in providing, you are lacking. God, where are you lacking? God said to me, literally, and this is the part that I got a problem saying. This is the part that I have a problem with, but this is the part that God said. There are people in the church, their wife, their husband in the church right now that are struggling with this. Their husband there doing a good job physically, providing for their household, their necessary need, but they are lacking. And God said, Marzo, you come on, you are lacking. You're not there for your wife emotionally. And that was a dagger to my heart. As I'm right at my bedside, kneeling and praying and asking God to make my wife come and make it right. God says, you are not there for her emotionally. And that's part of keep it. Exercise, protect. You need to protect her emotionally. And God said, there are people, there are wives, right now in the church, husbands are not there for them emotionally. And right there, God says, Kermani, it begins with you. And that's where the topic comes from. It begins with me. It begins with me to go and make peace. It begins with me to make sure the environment that is in my house is the environment that God wants to be in that house. It begins with me as a man to prepare to make sure my house is such a place that my wife wants to be. It begins with me. And if you think you are that emotionally connected to your wife, be honest, wife, with them. Just ask her. Ask her if I am here for you emotionally. And wife, be honest with them. And you would shock. You would shock to find out. And then I decide I'm going to go into a little survey and look that up. And to my surprise, 7 out of 10, based on my survey, 7 out of 10 wives complain that their husband doesn't connect with them emotionally. That's a survey that you could look into. So that's telling me that we men not doing a good job by connecting with our wife emotionally. While we are doing a good job at times providing, but we are not providing that emotional support. And that is very crucial. So man, its responsibility is given and to us to set the atmosphere within the house. If you look chapter 16, verse 16, 17, you realize that after God put out the man in the garden, he also gave him rules. Who did the man get? God give? 16, he said, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but the tree of the knowledge good and evil thou shalt not eat of. For the day that thou eatest, therefore thou shalt surely die. So after God gave the man a home with the Garden of Eden, he told him what to do, to dress it and to keep it. Then he gave him rules. There cannot be a house that can function without guidelines. We need guidelines. We need guidelines in our house. There are some boundaries that are not supposed to cross. There are rules. If you look at verse 18 now, it says, and the Lord God said, it is what? Not good for a man to be alone. I will make him a helper for him. Some version said, help meet. Some version said, helper suitable. God, after his creation, everything, day one, he said it was. Day two was. Day three. Day four. Day five. Day six. But when it comes down, God says it was not good. That's the only part of God's creation where God said it's not good. And that part was for a man to be alone. It's not good. And if you look, verse 19 and 20, all the animals, Adam gave them names. And anything Adam called them, that's what they are. And if you look at the ending part in verse 20, it says, but unto Adam there was no helpmeet for him. So Adam is naming all those animals and everything of his kind of his peer. But for Adam, there was none. In other words, then, the animal kingdom, Adam mate could not come from the animals. That shows in us that human being human being is higher than animal. Human are human and animals are animals. Because if we were animals, then Adam mate could come from the animal kingdom. But none was suitable for Adam. So that is telling me that this goes totally against bestiality. And I love dogs, don't get me wrong. I love dogs. But dogs are not human beings. They are dogs. They are animals. But pay attention here. Pay attention very carefully to what's taking place here. Verse 21, and the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept, and the Lord took a rib and closed up the flesh instead thereof. So known in the animal kingdom, and God said it's not good. So God is going to provide him a helpmeet, helper. Some versions say helper. But ladies, don't get too mad at me for using that word helper. You see, that word helper The English language don't do justice with that word. You see, that word helper is Ezer, E-Z-E-R. The Hebrew term is Ezer. It literally means, as the idea to supply something critical that the word Ezer has the idea of supplying something critical that is lacking and it most often refer to God. If you read Psalms 30 verse 10 and Psalms 54 verse 4, you realize that when David is crying out to God for help, that's a word he's used, Ezer. He said, "You are my help." That's the same word translate, and that's the same word that used to describe the woman. Ladies, you need to pay attention to this. That's why when God creates you as a helper to your husband, it doesn't mean that you are your husband's maid. That's not the implication there. What the implication there is that God creates you as a source of strength to your husband. God creates you as a tower of strength for your husband. And if you look, God himself could not conclude creation without make woman. You see, creation was incomplete without woman. And there's a reason for that. Because without a woman, Adam was all by himself. And creation was incomplete also without woman. So God made woman so creation could be complete. Creation could be complete. So God takes the ribs from Adam. Where from Adam? From the side. God takes the rib from the side, symbolizing the equality, symbolizing that she belongs at your side, not at the head, so she rules over you, not from your feet, so you trampled on her, right from the side. Right from the side. Men and women are equal in the sight of God, but the roles are different. The roles are different, but they are equal. So God put Adam to sleep and make a woman. And when Adam woke up, Adam saw somebody that he had never seen before. Somebody that looks like him. Somebody that he could relate to. And Adam, right here, Adam started to, the first man to give a girl sweet words. Adam said, "Come on, you are now bones of my bones. You are now flesh of my flesh. You shall call woman because you were taken out of man." Right here, even before Eve realized that she needed emotional support, Adam was right there invalidating her. Right there, invalidating her husband. At times, we fail in our job by not giving our wife the compliments that they do deserve. We don't tell them we love them enough. We don't tell them how beautiful they are. We don't tell them how important they are in our life. Sometimes, we do not do a good job validating our spouse. And right here, Adam, this man of words, goes on to say, "Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and the two shall become one flesh." one flesh. One flesh. You see, that bond that God have from marriage, we must be so closely joined together. That's why God said, what God has joined together, let no man put asunder. In other words, let no man pull apart. You see, if you crazy glue two containers together and you want to pull it apart before it pull apart at times, it will get broken. And even when it gets broken, a part of the next part still remain and the other part. That's how closely we need to closely join to our wife that it next to impossible to be pulled apart. You see, God wants that within our marriage for us to be closely linked, for us closer joined together. But how can we get there, man? It begins with me. Ladies, it begins with me. It begins with me. But come on, this is not a New Year sermon. Yet it is. Yes, it is. Why? Because the church can be as strong as the families are. You see, if the families are not strong, then the church are not strong. So yes, this is a New Year sermon to let wife and husband come together, that joint that God has joined you together. You said, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, till death do us part. That bond that God bound you. You see, God says to me that, Kerman, I made you the us bond. In other words, the house bond. In other words, it is the us bond responsibility to bond the family together. The us oath ban. To ban and keep the family intact. And what's a wife's responsibility? She is the helper to stand beside, to uphold, to she should be the cheerleader for the husband. And God is saying us, for 2015, we have not been the husband, we have not been the wife that we ought to be. But come this 2016, we can make a difference and make our house a little heaven on earth. I admit, I messed up. I was the first to say it. So you could stay there and deny how perfect, how wonderful husband you are. I just said it. I messed up. And I'm saying this because God would not have me preach the sermon that I want to preach. And I could see the intense looks and the faces. And you know yourself that you are not... You wasn't that supportive spouse that you're supposed to be last year. But you could make it better this year. You could make it better. You could keep the garden. Look, skip with me to chapter 3. Chapter 3. Look at chapter 3, verse 9. Chapter 3, verse 9. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? Okay, back up. Look at verse 6 of chapter 3. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and it was what? Pleasant to the eyes, and the tree that desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and she eat. And gave also to her husband, with her husband, and he did eat. Who ate the fruit first? Eve. Who God calls? Adam. Why God caused Adam? Because he was the one over in chapter 2, verse 15, that he gave the garden to just and to keep. So the responsibility falls on Adam. Eve went out and Eve did wrong, but Eve did wrong. Where were Adam? Where were Adam? Adam was in the garden with Eve, because that was their house. But they were disconnected. Adam was east, one was west. Ellen G. White says that she was by doing her daily work in the garden, she strayed away. So by doing what she's doing, she strayed away. And then she found herself at the tree. But where was Adam? So God called Adam, and the responsibility was given to him. So what happened, Adam? The family altar break down. What happened, Adam? So man, it's very important. It is crucial. It's our responsibility to make sure, not just to provide physical support, but also emotional and spiritual guides, spiritual leadership. Spiritual leadership in our homes. In our homes need spiritual leadership. Leadership that our wife could look to. It's our responsibility. It begins with me. If my house gonna be a better place, it begins with me. And then Adam wanna blame Eve, and Eve wanna blame the serpent. Adam wanna blame God, because Adam said, "The woman you gave me." And Eve wanna blame the serpent, but always remember, God caused Adam. Not because God didn't know where Adam was. Adam, where are you? Did you eat from that tree that I told you you're not supposed to? Man, God has given you your house, your family. If you realize that God was the one, it says over in chapter 2, that brings the woman to the man, right there in the garden. So God was the first giveaway father. He makes the woman compatible for Adam. Place her in the arms and under the protection of the man. So it is only right that when things go wrong, then God has to call on the man who he placed the woman into his arms. And you and I are responsible for our families, because we will have to answer to God. We will have to answer to God for the family that he placed in your hands. Man, it begins with you. You could turn this thing around. It begins with you. Bible verse, please. First Peter 3 verse 7. It says, likewise, ye what? Husband, dwell with them according to the knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers do not hinder. Man, it's very important how we treat, deal, handle, speak everything to our wife. And that's why God said, get up off your knees, Kermani, and go make right. Go do what's right. I won't answer that prayer. I won't answer that prayer. Because you have not been the person that you ought to be. And right there at my bedside, God said, get up off your knees. Next verse, please. Submit yourself one to another in the fear of the Lord. Wife, submit yourself unto your own husband as unto the Lord. First, submit yourself one to another as in the fear of the Lord. So with that, there's mutual submission. But then it goes deeper. It says, wife, submit to your own, not to every man, to your own husband. And there's a lot of different ideology what submit means. Submit means submit. I don't know what you want to turn it. It means submit. It doesn't mean dictate. It doesn't mean you push her around, though. It doesn't mean that everything you said goes. That's not what it meant. But it means, wife, you are to allow your husband to be the husband in the home. You are to respect him in such a way. You are to esteem him, so esteem him high. But preacher, what if I have a husband that is not God-fearing? Must I still submit? Submit to your husband as unto the Lord. I can't get no plainer than that. Next verse, please. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Husband is the head, spiritual leadership, the head of the wife. This have nothing to be that the woman is under the man. They are equal. But God placed the headship to the husband. So that's why when things are not right in the house, because the husband is the head, it's his responsibility, even when the wives are wrong, it's his responsibility to go and fix it. Why? Because you are the head, and you are representing Christ inside your house. Next verse. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives submit to their own husband in everything. Oh, you digest that. Remember, the everything has to come under the umbrella as everything has to Christ. You don't tell your wife to go do some real crazy stuff and you expect her to do it. That's not what it's talking. That's not what the everything. Just as the Bible says, children, obey your parents in the Lord. Your children have a right to disobey you if you tell them to do something that's not right. So that everything doesn't mean everything. Remember, Paul is talking to the church. So everything under the umbrella of God. Under the spiritual leadership, under the umbrella of God. So don't walk away, think you have the right to go and boss your wife around. That's not what I'm saying. Next verse, please. Husband, love your wife. Wife. Remember, there's an S, so it's husbands and wife. I try to get this part very correctly. Because I don't want you to walk away and say, oh, I could have wives. Also remember, it's a husband. So it means that more than one. It means all of us as husbands need to love our wife. Are that clear? All right. Even as husband love your wife, even as Christ also loves the church and gave himself for it. Do you love your wife that much that you will give yourself for her? Think about it. If you want to be the head and you are going to say, I am the head, then if you don't love your wife that much, then you don't fit to be the head. Look at it. Gave yourself for it. Christ gave his life for the church. Are you ready for that? Next verse, please. Next one. Next one. Okay. So ought a man to love man to love their wife as their own body. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. If he that loveth his wife loveth himself. So he that hateth his wife hateth himself. That's a word. That's a word. And that's what God is calling us to be in this 2016, is to be that spouse, that husband, that wife that bands together. Next text, please, Colossians. Husband, love your wives and be not bitter against them. Let me read that again. Husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them. Yes, they will say hurtful stuff. Yes, they might do hurtful stuff. But God is calling you to love your wives. Don't be bitter with them. Don't be mad with them. You want to be the head? It comes also with everything. And that's what God wants us to be. Slides, please. That's what God is calling us to be. Love your wife. Don't bitter with them. First, F-I-R-S-T. F, friend. First, put God first. First, God, your first friend. Your first interest, God. The first person you need to be in relationship with is God. The first person on your schedule, God. The first person you call on when you're in trouble, God. Are you getting the church? First, remember that. Friend, interest, relationship, schedule, trouble, God. First. Next slide, please. Push. Push. Pray. Pray until something happens. That's what we need to do if we are going to make our home the place that God wants, the way God wants it to be. First, God got to be first. And second, we got to push. We got to push, church. We got to pray until something happens. The atmosphere in your home is not right. Push. Your children are not behaving the way they should behave. Push. financial problem, push. Whatsoever problem occurring in your home, push. Pray until something happens. For this 2016 church, we are going to push. We are going to what, church? Push. Next slide, please. Victory. God first, then you push, then comes the victory. V, value. You got to value your time with God. I, intentional. You got to be intentional about it. C, courage. You got to have the courage to stand up for what's right, to stand up for what's true. T, trust. Trust in God, don't matter what. Trust in God. O, obedient. It doesn't matter what you're going through, always obey the word of God. Obey God. Obey God. The reason why I preach this sermon today is because I have been obedient to God. R, resist. Resist Satan. You see, Satan is going to put stuff in your way. You see, at times you might look and you might say, the grass over the other side might look greener. Resist those temptations. It might look greener. It's not greener. It's Satan setting it up that way. Resist. Why? Heal. Heal to the Holy Spirit. When you're on your knees and the Spirit is speaking to you, heal. When you're about to step out to do wrong and the Spirit is bidding you, heal. Victory is yours, church. You could get the victory over your sins. You could get the victory over your temptation. The Bible said there's not a... Paul said that there's always be a way of escape that God already prepared for you. There's a way out. He won't give you more than you can bear. Victory can be yours, but you got to put Christ first. You got to push. And as I'm going to close, last text. I want you to pay attention to this very text very carefully. It comes from Songs of Solomon. And it says, oh, my dove, that art in the cliff of my rock, in the secret place of the stairs, let me see thy countenance. Let my heart, let me hear thy voice. For sweet is thy voice, and thy countenance is comely. Dove. There's something, next verse. There's something about a dove and a pigeon. A dove and a pigeon. You see that word dove. They use the dove because of the calmness of the dove. The meekness of the dove. You see, if there's a dove and a pigeon in your house, if you have a dove and a pigeon in your house, whenever there are intense argument, the dove will fly away. Because a dove cannot stay where there's too much animosity. The dove spirit, you see, remember when Jesus got baptized, the Holy Spirit was like a dove. So the dove will fly away. So you got to make your home in such a way that the dove will stay. The dove will stay. Look at this. Pay attention to this. He said, take us the foxes, the little fox that spoil the vines, for our vines have tender grapes. You know what that means? The little fox, Solomon here is talking about his love life. The little fox, those are the little things that comes between you and your wife. Those are the little facts that come into the relationship to ruin it. That's the little fact that he's talking about, that the vines are tender. The vines are tender. We got to kill those little facts, those little things that tearing us apart, those little things that are pulling us together. Solomon is saying that we need to get rid of them. The stuff, the things that you are doing that's annoying your spouse, get rid of those little facts. They will kill, they will destroy the love life between you and your wife. Those little facts. As I'm going to close, I want to close, and I don't close without an appeal. As the praise team getting ready to sing, "Just As I Am," I want to close with this appeal, calling for some husbands. Husbands, if you purpose in your heart to make your home in such an environment that is conducive for your wife and your children, you want to stand with me. Could you please stand with me? Husbands, you want to stand with me? If you want to stand with me, stand. Stand with me, husband. Show your wife that you are determined to be a better husband moving forward this 2016. Just as I am, without one plea. Stand. Husband, remain standing. Where the congregation, please sit. Can't sing. If you're serious about it, as they say, "Oh Lamb of God, I come," and you want to walk out of your seat and come to the altar, because you are, by walking, you're telling your wife that I am going to be a better husband 2016. I am going to be a better husband. So if you want to come, "Oh Lamb of God, I come," walk down to the altar. Walk down to the altar. Continue singing, please. I could I could hear the husband saying, "So, Kerman, what about the wife? Wife, if you are willing to be the cheerleader for your husband, please stand. Please stand. If you're willing to be a cheerleader for your husband, if you're willing to be the helper that God created you to be for him, please stand. Please stand. And if your husband is down at the altar, please come join him. Please come join your husband." And everybody now who is in agreement with this message, please stand. And we are going to sing. First elder to pray this special prayer on behalf of the couples, that the men, they stood up and they said, "I want to be a better husband." The wives support them and say, "I want to be their cheerleaders. I'm going to be their cheerleaders." So I want your sister Baptiste to put us in God's hands. And then we sing the verse again, and then Bob will do his benediction.
Let us pray. Oh, Father in heaven, we thank you for the commitment that each person has made to you. We thank you, Lord, for the men in our lives, the men in our church who are determined to stand for right and to stand for you and to be the pillars of faith in their homes. Lord, we thank you for the women that you have given them, and we ask that each one of us would represent you well. We also want to pray today, Lord, for the men who are not husbands, but they are sons of yours. And we want to pray for the daughters, your daughters who are not wives, that each one of us would represent you well wherever you have placed us. Help us in our sphere of influence to remain faithful until your kingdom comes. In your name we pray. Amen.
Father, you're the only one that can do the work that needs to be done in each one. And Father, create in us a clean heart and renew a right spirit in each one of us, I pray. We ask in your Son's name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.